Members to the 28th meeting in 2014 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, and as always, ask members to turn off their mobile phones, please. Agenda item one is decision on taking business in private. It's proposed that we take items 7 and 8 in private. Item 7 is consideration of the Delegated Powers provisions in the Mental Health Scotland Bill at stage one. It's also suggested that we take further stage one consideration of the bill in private. Item 8 is consideration of a draft report on the Welfare Funds Scotland Bill. Does the committee agree to take those items in private, please? Kim? Does the committee also agree to take further consideration of the Mental Health Scotland Bill at stage one in private? Kim? Members will also note that in line with the previous decisions of the committee, items 9 and 10 will also be in private. Agenda item 2 then is the Legal Writings, Counterparts and Delivery Scotland Bill. And we're in a position to take further oral evidence on the bill. Today we hear from representatives from the academic and business sectors, as well as from the Register of Scotland. And I welcome this morning in the first panel Professor George Gretton, who's the Lord President Reid Professor of Law at the University of Edinburgh. Dr. Gillian Black, who's Senior Lecturer in Law, also from Edinburgh University. And Dr. Ross Anderson, who's an Advocate and Honorary Research Fellow at the University of Glasgow. Good morning, one and all. Thank you very much for coming along. And I will open our questioning, if I may, just by asking you whether you can give us any examples, as you see it, of the practical difficulties of the inability to sign contracts in Counterparts at the moment, please.
Thank you. I suppose I can speak only from my experience in practice, which was 10 years ago now. I spent 3.5 years in commercial practice. And I would repeat the evidence that you've heard already. I understand from people like Paul Halley from Shepherd and Wedderburn. I would certainly confirm that there have been occasions where contracts which have been progressing under Scots law have been changed at the 11th hour to English law to enable execution and counterpart. Whether that's strictly necessarily legal or not required, it has been something that happens, and I've had the experience of that in practice.
But that reflects my own experience also. It is commonly done, particularly in relation to areas of law. The substance of the law is essentially the same between the jurisdictions. Take a share purchase agreement. Company law is essentially the same between Scotland and England. It's a UK Companies Act. The governing law, though, has to be Scotland or England. All the parties are Scottish, the company's Scottish, everything to do with the transaction is Scottish. The parties want to execute under Scots law, but as the 11th hour approaches, as Gillian has indicated, it becomes clear that some of the parties are not going to be available to all come to one room to sign on the dotted line. And the view is taken that the easiest thing to do is to simply change the governing law clause and execute under English law. There is an issue about whether all of this is actually already competent at common law in Scotland, but the law is not clear, and the view is taken that it is more certain to change the governing law clause and do so under English law. It is a very real issue.
Yeah, I think we understand that giving more certainty, or indeed certainty, is precisely what this bill's about, and I recommend that. I'm wondering if I could take Stuart Stevenson first, please.
I just wanted to pick up on what Dr. Anderson said very precisely. He used the word commonly done. And I just wanted to explore whether you could give the committee any sense as to the frequency, because the word commonly, we may have individual views as to what that might mean. And I just want to test what is meant by commonly.
It's a very good question, which is a question that is difficult to answer. That term I've used is to some extent deliberately vague. And let me explain what I mean by that. In my daily practice as an advocate, I'm not involved in any transactions, concluding transactions at all. My experience is based on such experiences I had as a solicitor. And insofar as this occurred, particularly in the corporate world, insofar as any signatory may not be present, this was a very real issue from the very beginning of a transaction which would support the choice of English law on a matter where English law is roughly identical anyway. And one can really put it no more than that. It always depends on the circumstance, but everyone who's been involved in these will have had occasions when that is done, and it's not infrequent. And common beyond that, I'm afraid, is a deliberately vague in general term. I don't have statistics.
I accept that. However, you have now put into play another question, because you made reference to this happening at the outset, whereas Dr. Black was, in her experience, specifically referring to the 11th hour change, which we've, as a committee, heard about. And I just wondered whether that specific at the outset would be the greater part of the such occurrences or the 11th hour. And indeed, while I'm addressing these questions to you, Dr. Anderson, it may well be the experience of others should be brought to bear.
I'll just answer that point very briefly, which is it always depends on the facts. You may know from the outset that parties are based in Vancouver, Berlin and Cape Town, all of whom may be Scots who just happen now to be living there. So it depends. That may only come to light at the 11th hour. Depends on the facts.
I'm content.
Thank you. Did Margaret want to come in?
No.
We're in the same place. Thank you. I'm wondering then if you could also just comment on the suggestion we heard last week, which is that parties will actually choose the legal system they want because of the characteristics of that legal system. I must confess, my perception is that Scottish law and English law are essentially the same on commercial, in many commercial areas, for precisely the reasons we're aware of. To what extent does the choice of law affect the way this operates, please?
In commerce, people have a tendency to choose English law. To some extent, it's a matter of prejudice. It's so standard. Internationally, English law and New York law are constantly chosen. And I sometimes think that if the law of Scotland was dictated to us by God himself, so that it was the perfect legal system, to some extent, choice of English law would carry on regardless. Because of tradition and prejudice, indeed, and because people do what they're used to doing. So I think that if this reform were made, I don't think this is going to suddenly make a huge change, but it would make some change, because there obviously are cases where this is the particular factor that makes people opt for English law. Sometimes there are other factors as well which make people opt for English law, but this can be one of them. So this would be a useful step, but it's not going to absolutely transform things. But nevertheless, it seems sensible to me.
Right, thank you. Stuart?
Thank you. Professor Gretton, you mentioned about the prejudice there. It certainly kind of struck me when you mentioned it. Can you explain a bit further as to the reasoning why you used that word, please?
I think people tend to assume that English law is good law, the best law, and without really examining other legal systems. The Scots law is not the only legal system that gets squeezed in this way in favor of English law, and on a global scale, New York law as well. Other legal systems as well, you know, around Europe, every legal system is getting squeezed. So it's not just an issue for Scots law. There are, of course, in a sense, transaction costs for people to find out about different legal systems. They know about English law, they know about New York law. It takes time and trouble to find out about Dutch law or Scots law or wherever. So to that extent, it is rational to that extent, because it does cost money to find out about other legal systems. One can understand it. But I think there is, beyond that, there is a certain irrationality. People tend to think English law is good law when, in my view, on the whole, Scots law is better.
Yeah, thank you.
Subject to qualifications, but in general, that's my view.
Oh, thank you very much.
Just if I may test that, because Scots law obviously has, sitting as a layperson, two parts to it. In other words, what is defined as being the law, but then there is also the process that's associated with it. When you make your remark, are you perhaps pointing to superior process and perhaps the quality of the practitioners in Scotland, rather than what is actually on the page as law, which I think was acknowledged in earlier contributions, is essentially the same. The same in effect, if not in words.
I would be reluctant to comment on the comparative ability of leading practitioners in Scotland or in England. All I can say is that in a lifetime of experience, I've come across so many superb practitioners in Edinburgh and Glasgow, elsewhere in Scotland, no doubt as well, but Edinburgh and Glasgow in particular, people who have really impressed me. And I don't think, although I've come across numerous practitioners in London and elsewhere, I don't think they're any better. But I'm an academic, so I'm not sure I can really give a full answer to that question.
Yeah, I think we're going to leave that discussion there, if we may, and I'm going to move us hastily on to John Scott, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Stone. Could I just ask you all for a view on what the practical and economic benefits of the new system might be for businesses in Scotland? Professor Gretton suggested a moment ago, if I understood you correctly, that it wasn't necessarily going to be transformative in terms of sudden rush of business to Scotland. Is that a view that you all share?
In general terms, yes, we're a small system. Business around the world is not going to flock to Scotland just because of the way one can sign a document. What I think, however, is crucial in this discussion is that Scotland stops exporting transactions carried out by the ordinary people of Scotland, Scottish businesses, Scottish companies relating to assets in Scotland. And if we can't persuade our own citizenry to use our own law, I think that reflects poorly on the content of our law. Now, to some extent, as George Gretton's already touched upon, some of the practice in this area of the law is not entirely rational. In 100 years' time, sociologists may wonder what we were doing with these scanning of pages. But that is what the market is comfortable with, and the empirical evidence suggests that without this bill, many contracts which would otherwise be governed by Scots law will be governed by English law, although there's no other great connection with England.
I'd agree with that.
Yeah, very much so. I don't know that it's going to attract business to Scotland, but it will hopefully stop some contracts being governed by English law instead, where the only reason for that choice is the execution and counterpart advantage.
Would you like to talk about the risks attached to this? In terms of small towns and smaller legal practices, do you see benefits for them? Presumably they would be confined to Scots law and would not, where it's businesses, local businesses. Do you see benefits in that area for them?
Yes, sir. And I think the geography of Scotland suggests that counterpart execution may be of particular relevance to so-called small town cases for businesses in the Highlands and Islands, the Hebrides. Trying to get people on a cold November evening to take ferries and trains to Inverness is not easy. And actually, one can see in Scotland, in particular, in my view, considerable benefit for small town transactions insofar as they want to avail themselves of this. This is not obligatory, it's merely facilitative.
Thank you. Could I just ask you, the previous panels suggested that the new law could be of use beyond large commercial contracts, as it would allow businesses to set up new ways of signing electronically, hence stimulating innovation. Do you see an opportunity, as academics, if you like, for new and innovative ways being developed on the back of this legislation of signing?
I'm not sure I've got any particular comment on that one, I'm afraid. Sorry. Okay. Don't know if my colleagues have.
No. Okay, thank you. I think that's probably, I think you've answered all the questions I have. Thank you.
Right, thank you. I think we then turn to Margaret.
Good morning. We've heard evidence from different groups of people about the possible increase of fraud that could happen, or error, with the introduction of the signatories. Can you tell me, are you aware of any examples of fraud or error that has occurred previously using the English system?
I'm not aware of that in England. No doubt that does happen. Fraud can happen with our system. For example, a few years ago, there was a solicitor in Aberdeen who substituted the earlier unsigned pages in deeds transferring property so as to insert his name rather than that of his client. And he would then register that. And he did this more than once. And so one can, there is a risk in these things. I don't think the bill would increase the risk. I don't think it decreases it, but I don't see it significantly increasing the risk.
Dr. Black?
So I'll just follow up, and I've read the evidence that you've heard from other witnesses, and I would certainly agree that there's potential, if people are interested in committing fraud or out to do so, then there are certainly potential for them to do so at the moment. I would agree that it doesn't necessarily increase the risk, even though if it doesn't head it off at the pass.
I would agree with that. I don't agree, for example, with the view that there is some danger of fraud lurking in this bill. That is a danger, I think, which is inherent in our present system. As George has already mentioned, if one has a pile of paper and it's only the last page of the document that is signed, one has another 250 pages that could be swapped away at will under the present hard copy wet ink system. To some extent, documents are generated within a PDF format as the master copy. Of course, no doubt it may be possible to interfere with that copy in some way, I don't know. But first of all, it's a little more difficult, actually. And it will hopefully leave some sort of digital trail for litigators like me to follow up if there's a dispute.
I don't know whether we can bring Stuart in on that, because this might be a good place for electronic signatures.
Indeed. I'll just make the observation. I have software that I use for quite legitimate purposes that enables me to edit PDFs as a matter of normal practice. So there is no fee for this advice. I merely say do not rely for security on the fact you've stuffed something in a PDF. However, let's move to something of more substance and weight. Given that the whole point about electronic signatures is that it preserves the unique single possible source of the signature, which is similar to a written signature, with all the caveats that one might attribute to either of those statements, but also ensures that the signature reflects the totality of the content of the document, why has there been thus far substantial reluctance to adopt electronic and furthermore the ability to sign at distance, which is part of all this? Why has there been a reluctance to adopt this?
That is an excellent question.
Which means it's not an easy question to answer, then. Is that correct?
Exactly. When a student asks me a question which I can't answer, I always say that's a very good question. The possibility of completely electronic documents, electronically signed with an advanced signature, finally arrived earlier this year, I think it was May. And that is sometimes called pure or pure electronic documents with pure electronic signatures. Your question is, why has that not been adopted or not been significantly adopted? Harking back to having said that's a good question, I don't know the answer. I think one issue is about the availability of advanced electronic signatures, not sufficiently widely available. Another is that it's still a bit science fiction for many people out there, including sophisticated commercial practitioners. They're familiar with paper and wet ink, they're familiar with scanning and PDFs, but the idea of pure electronic documents is, I think, one which they're not very familiar with. Maybe it's going to be different in 10 years' time, and maybe this this bill will look pretty old-fashioned in 10 years' time. Maybe things will move on. We'll be in a pure electronic world. And that is, of course, more secure, or at least so the techies tell me, that pure electronic documents are more secure. So why is it not used? I think those are two reasons. There are the questions about the wide availability of advanced electronic signatures, and simply that people are not used to that idea yet. It's too advanced for them. But this is me guessing. I'm an academic, and this is me guessing. I don't know. I haven't been out there and said to people, why aren't you doing this? It's also very new, because it only came in May, and these things take time. To some extent, generational, indeed.
I just make the observation, Mary, Queen of Scots, was born in 1542, and the process that she used of single keys that no one shared was one she used to correspond with her lovers, and it's exactly that process that we're looking at here. All we're now looking at is the key is an electronic one. So, in fact, the concepts involved in this are at least 450 years old. And in the electronic world, electronic signatures have been in legally enforceable use for over 30 years. So this is also free advice. Thank you. It's time it was...
Maybe the committee should amend in the word lovers into this bill. It would certainly have a bigger impact.
I feel the convener's discomfort at where we're going with this, so I will...
I'm wondering if I could drag us back to Margaret.
Could I ask your views on the faculty's suggestion last week in its oral evidence on the 30th of September that risks could be reduced if the parties are required to deliver entire document and counterpart, that is, not just the signature pages? And could you also tell me, would this suggestion be commercially realistic?
I think we've discussed the potential for fraud at the moment. If you've got a hard copy document, it's easy enough to sub in new pages, whether the whole document or just particular ones, and that would remain even if you deliver the entire document, which has been signed. I also have concerns about the number of documents that would be floating about. If you've got four parties to the transaction, that would involve the exchange of 12 counterparts. So and exchanging 12 signature pages is manageable, feasible, but to exchange 12 counterparts of a 200-page contract becomes incredibly uncommercial, I would have thought.
When I first looked at this area of the law a number of years ago, it was as a result of receiving emails as the junior lawyer of signed signature pages and questioning perhaps what it was we were doing. And at that time, I may say that I, to some extent, shared the concern about whether this was really enough. My views on that have changed, and they've changed because the whole essence of counterpart execution is to avoid the delivery, whether in hard copy or electronic form, of the whole document. Now, if the committee were minded to recommend that the whole document should be transmitted, one might as well put a line through the whole first section of the bill. And the example Gillian gave, I think, is a good one, and one can multiply it easily. And I was trying to just do this myself last night. If one has a fairly short form share purchase agreement, which is 100 pages long, to which conceivably there could be, say, 50 signatories if there's 50 shareholders, that would be a document of 149 pages. Now, if one starts thinking that every party must send the whole document, instead of one would be in the situation of requiring about 7,500 pages or thereabouts to be exchanged for just one document. Now, many of these transactions will have literally hundreds of documents. So, again, it's a very pertinent question, I think, to ask of why just the signature pages. But that goes to the very heart of what counterpart execution is. And if the committee is satisfied with the policy or the idea of counterpart execution, as done in England and much of the world, to add on that additional requirement wouldn't take us much further on from where we already are, which is that one can deliver whole copies of documents.
Thank you.
I would agree. I would agree.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, Richard, do you want to carry on from
my question's on pre-signed signature pages. The policy memorandum states that these may be used if the party concerned clearly authorised or mandated this in advance, or subsequently ratified what had been done with foreknowledge or the content of the new document. Now, firstly, do you think that offers sufficient protection? But secondly, to what extent is it an issue anyway? Because the law firms who gave evidence on 30 September said they don't use pre-signature pages. So it would be helpful to know, you know, from you if you've got experience about actually how widely these are used anyway.
And actually, one question is, what is one doing here? And it seems to me the authorisation that's been given by a client in that situation is essentially a power of attorney to the solicitor to sign the document once the solicitor's seen the full document on behalf of the client. So this use of pre-signed signature pages, I confess I find odd. I think the basic principle which is contained in the policy memorandum is probably right, that if one had authorisation, this might be competent. I don't think many solicitors, speaking from my own point of view, would be willing to risk that.
So why do you think it's in the bill anyway then? I mean, why do we have to have this? I mean, is that because there's an expectation that they are going to be used more in the future? Or that there has to be, this is a guarantee that all bases are covered in legislation, or why is it there?
It's a good question. It may be simply to reflect some of the practices which are going on in England, and again, to be facilitative for cases which may arise. But again,
what cases would arise at this point? Where they've been required?
One of the difficulties with transactional practice is trying to see the future for every factual eventuality, and one needs an element of flexibility.
Can I just add in, I would agree that if the client wished to give authority to the solicitor to sign on his behalf, then the existing doctrine of agency would allow the client to do that and the solicitor to do that on their behalf. So I don't know that this adds anything. There's already existing provision to appoint an agent to sign on your behalf if you wish to do so.
Right, thank you, Richard. I think that takes us to Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. Can you tell me your views, please, on the likely benefits for business of the setting up of an electronic document repository maintained by the Registers of Scotland?
It's not in the bill, of course, because the view's taken that it doesn't need legislation. It seems to me a good idea. I would imagine it wouldn't be too difficult to set up. I think the fact that it would be run by Registers of Scotland will give it a credibility that wouldn't exist if it was offered in the private sector, or might not exist in the private sector. I think it's a good idea, and I imagine it's going to go ahead. When Registers of Scotland got the capacity at the moment, they're doing the transition to the new Land Registration Act, and that, I imagine, all hands on deck for that one. But once that comes into force, I think on the 8th of December, once that's settled down, I imagine they will turn to this. And what it's specifically your question, the business benefits, again, I'm an academic, I'm entirely reluctant to comment on that. But I would imagine that there is a very strong potential there. Yep.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Black or Dr. Anders?
Nothing further to add.
I think it's always difficult to know what the future holds. Some mention was made earlier of technology in the 16th century. Of course, paper and ink has been around for a long time and has generally proved itself to be pretty useful technology, and that it's durable. And at the moment, we have a register called the Books of Counsel and Session that has kept documents for literally hundreds of years, the originals. And I think the idea behind the repository, which in general terms I certainly support, is to have some digital archive with state backing that would ensure that electronic documents were archived in a way they would continue to be accessible. One difficulty, of course, with software, and I'm not a technical person, but I just speak from experience of trying to open up old documents, and they won't, is that software moves on, and there's a very real issue of retaining the old Betamax machine to watch the Betamax tapes. And it may be, to some extent, that I can see certainly major benefits to having an archive that would keep electronic documents in a form that, in 100 years' time, they would still be readable.
Would that be something that you would suggest that the Registers of Scotland, I mean, surely they would keep all their documents in accessible form rather than allow them to become redundant, essentially, because the technology to access them no longer existed. They would have to update them as time went on.
I fear we're straying into an area where I just lack the technical knowledge to comment further. I merely highlight the issue. It may be the others have something more to say.
Well, to some extent, Register Scotland are already there. To some extent, pure electronic documents are already registrable in the Land Register and also in the Books of Council and Session. And I believe that Register Scotland, that their resident techies have addressed this issue so that this stuff can be remain accessible even as the technology moves on. Now, how they do this, I don't know. I'm a cyber moron. But I think they have tackled this issue, and we're already there. We're already there. So there are already electronic documents, purely electronic documents registered, and if you apply for an official copy, you can get it. And apparently this is going to be a stable situation. But so I am told.
Thank you. Thank you, Kavira. I'm not a cybermodern for a variety of reasons. I just thought it would be useful to put on the record that an essential part of an electronic repository of information of any kind, which is going to endure, must also require that the full details of how the data is organised and the algorithms which are used to access it are also stored in perpetuity and are publicly available free from any commercial restrictions. If those tests are met, then electronic repositories that endure for the long term are sustainable. So, for example, something like PDFs that we've made referred to are actually a commercial product which can be changed by the manufacturer over time. So we do need to exercise care, and I think without getting involved in the technology itself, I think we should be clear that if we end up doing electronic depositories, we have to also deposit the means by which in perpetuity they can be accessed, not the programs, because the platforms the programs run on will become obsolete quickly, but the algorithms. And I just think for the record, it would be useful to perhaps express that.
Thank you. I think we're in your hands, Mike.
Thank you, convener. I just wonder if there are any other comments on the bill, and possibly the most difficult question of the lot, is there anything missing from the bill that, you know, something that perhaps ought to be in there that isn't?
One or two comments. I'd agree with Ross that it's unclear in Scots law as to whether the bill is needed or not, and my personal view is that it's not required. It would be open to the parties to execute documents in this way if they wish, although I accept that there is a lot of commercial concern about that, so I think that the certainty it provides is very welcome. But because I think that it's not, strictly speaking, essential that the parties could execute documents in this way, then I think it's important that this is light touch, and I have two queries about the bill as drafted at the moment. The first is, what is the position where a contract does not need to be executed in this way at all? And most commercial contracts would not need to be executed formally in writing at all, let alone executed in counterpart. But if the parties choose to do so, but then fail to comply with the provisions of the Act, so they've opted to use the scheme available in the Act, but then fail to do so for some reason, does that mean that their contract is not properly concluded and not enforceable, even though there's no need for them to opt in? But if they choose to opt in, what is the position if they then fail to comply? And some clarity on that would be welcome, I think. My other concern is with clause 1, subclause 3, which states that on such execution, the counterparts are to be treated as a single document. And I think my interpretation of that would be that it creates a legal fiction that two documents or more documents become one, three become one, the holy trinity of contract law, perhaps. And I would prefer that instead of saying that three become one or two become one, it would be also adequate and create less of a fiction to simply say that regardless of how many parts a document is executed in, it is still a valid contract. So that instead of deeming several parts to be one, we simply accept that it does not invalidate a contract to be executed in multiple parts. So those are my two observations on the bill.
I have one or two, and I should probably put these in writing, just for clarity at some stage. But it's not on the counterpart side. It's on the delivery of traditional documents by electronic means. So we're talking about Section 4 here. And the provisions are drafted with contracts in mind, and that makes sense. But the wording covers documents other than contractual documents. I'll try to be brief. I'll start with one point, which is subsection 6 of section 4. Although delivery by electronic means, that's of a traditional document, constitutes effective delivery in relation to a traditional document, what's received by that means is not to be treated as being a traditional document itself, which is not perhaps immediately obvious what it means. It wasn't immediately obvious to me what it means, and I looked back to the Scottish Law Commission report, and one thing it's supposed to mean is that that document, as electronic delivered, PDF, is not itself to be registrable in, for example, the Land Register, Books of Council and Session. And as a drafting point, I thought perhaps that section could be amended to make that point quite clear, because it wasn't clear to me reading this code, and I think I'm a pretty good reader of statutes and I have a pretty good knowledge of the law's background, but it didn't come home to me. So that would be good if Section 6 could be amended to make it not registrable. And I have another point, which is this. If we turn away from contractual documents to, say, a conveyance of land, and I have a conveyance of land here, and this refers to the... we have a conveyance of land here, and it's on two pages. There's page one, and there's page two. And just go to page two, and there are signatures there. Now, this says that a document can be delivered, section four, by just parts. So if this page was faxed, that would constitute delivery of the disposition. But that's going to be no use to a buyer, because most of the deed isn't there. And secondly, even if, by the way, they did get the whole deed, they still couldn't register it because of subsection 6. So this project's been driven by contracts, and I fully understand that, and as I say, I'm supportive of the bill. But I think possibly a certain amendment would be appropriate to cover the point I've made, but I could put this in writing. In writing of some sort, yes.
Yes, I think it would be extremely helpful.
Yeah. I will fax a PDF to you.
Indeed, not least, of course, because it would be helpful for the Law Commission to be able to respond to that to us, because they probably thought about that at some stage, though I don't remember everything they wrote down, of course. Thank you for those interesting observations. Does Dr. Anderson want to?
Just add a couple in. My observations are really linked to both of the prior observations, which is just to try and keep in view some of the different subjects which this bill will deal with. George has given the example of a unilateral deed which may have to be registered and therefore has to be delivered in order to be effectual in terms of Section 4. Section 1 of the bill is directed, as has been discussed in evidence you've already heard, with regard to mainly commercial contracts. And that takes us to the issue which Gillian has raised with regard to what if there's a mistake made and it's not executed in accordance with the bill. And I think there's a couple of observations to be made about that. The first one is, of course, most commercial contracts don't have to be in writing at all. It would be perfectly competent for the parties just to meet over a cup of tea or a strong drink to work out what it is they want to agree and for money to change hands on that basis. Of course, if the parties have gone to the trouble of spending money on their lawyers to negotiate detailed terms for many months, they want to ensure that they don't have issues about those terms actually forming part of their contract. And that is why they then seek to execute the document in such a way as to benefit from the presumptions which the Requirements of Writing Scotland Act will confer upon them, namely that if it's been signed at the end of the last page, it is presumed to have been signed by the grantor, and then that all the terms are so incorporated. If a contract does not require to be in writing, however, a mere failure in this procedure or any other procedure under the 1995 Act doesn't necessarily invalidate the contract. It just means that one is going to have greater difficulties in proving either whether the contract was concluded at all, and if so, what are the terms of that contract? And I think that is a very simple point to make, but certainly when I listened to some of the other evidence, I wasn't sure that point always came out. This bill must always be looked at in the context of the requirements of writing Scotland Act 1995. And the document that George referred to, for example, is a document that must be in writing, that's normally unilateral, and therefore requires delivery. But that's a slightly different issue than the commercial contracts situation, which is why for the contracts that don't need to be in writing, delivery just of the signature pages is normally sufficient, because there's a master copy of the document somewhere else and it's not going to be registered anywhere. So that there are different issues relating to different documents, which I'm not sure have always been kept fully clear.
Thank you. And that kind of takes me on to my next question, which is, do you agree with the general approach of the bill being facilitative rather than prescriptive? Very succinct answer, yes. Very useful. Thank you.
Okay, I think that brings us, all of a sudden it seems, to the end of our questions. Is there anything that our witnesses would like to add at this stage? Clearly, as previously indicated, any further thoughts in writing will be appreciated, and I recognise why people sometimes want to put them in writing so they've got their thinking clear on a complicated subject. So can I thank you very much indeed for your evidence to us, and we'll briefly suspend while we change over the panel. Thank you.
Can I reopen the meeting and welcome Stephen Hart, who's legal counsel from the Braveheart Investment Group, PLC, and Catherine Corr, who's principal solicitor from Scottish Enterprise. Thank you very much for coming. And I think we're essentially going to run through the same script, as it were, because the questions are relatively obvious. And we'd just like to get some consistency in what we hear. So I'm wondering whether I can start and ask you whether you feel there are practical difficulties in the current state of Scots law.
Yes, I do.
Answers on a postcard, please.
Yeah.
Discuss. Thank you.
Absolutely. I think. Yeah.
I agree. I think there are probably a number of practical difficulties, and I see a number of legal difficulties or situational difficulties that arise as well. On the practical side, I think you've heard a weight of evidence that suggests that transactions sometimes outrun the lawyers that are managing them, and that consideration of the location and availability of signatories can change as the transaction progresses. For some deals, this means that people are considering at the outset what the law needs to be applied. For others, it's a very much a last-minute thing about availability. The number of parties can present a great difficulty. Dr. Anderson referred to share purchase agreements, which are primarily something that I have a great experience with in terms of corporate and investment agreements, where we have many, many parties, some of whom are only subsidiary, if at all, actors, just being shareholders of the company. And I think that those create delays and uncertainty in the transaction process. I think there are some legal difficulties or situational conflicts that arise. The first is that people become a little bit wary about being bound to a contract before they want to, so that if all parties are signing a round-robin document, perhaps rather than a completion meeting, theoretically, that document becomes binding when the last person has signed it. And actually, the parties may not intend that to be the case. That may be because there are that document is interconditional with other documents, and interconditionality raises a number of issues in larger corporate transactions, which having documents seemingly becoming effective at different times on different signatures can raise issues. And I think I have seen situations where people are using probative signatures under the Requirements of Writing Act, but bizarrely leaving them undated because of this concern that having actually signed it on the 7th of October, they were reluctant to put 7th of October against their signature because actually they know it's got to go round and we're not going to do the deal until the 10th. So I think there are both practical and a number of uncertainties on the legal front that arise.
Yes. I suspect most of us have been in a position of signing but not dating. I suspect it's the average way of buying a house, actually. Does Catherine Corr have anything to add to that?
Could I just ask you, have you any practical examples of with Scottish Enterprises' knowledge of big deals, as it were, where this has actually had an impact on them, or the current law as it stands?
Well, I think just to sort of echo the contributions that you've heard already, that the lack of clarity around counterpart execution does pose a practical difficulty for Scots lawyers in terms of large commercial firms and large commercial contracts, but also for the smaller firms. So an example would be a fairly recent one that came across my desk in terms of the work that Scottish Enterprise does. It was a license agreement with a US company the US is one of our biggest export markets, and you know, clearly we do a lot of business with the US in terms of across Scotland, and not only Scottish enterprises but Scottish businesses, and indeed we want to encourage that. And in this particular example, we had to make the kind of usual apology, if you like, for Scots law to the US company and say, I'm really sorry, you have to print out the document there. We can't sign it in Counterpart and take the deal as done. You'll need to courier that back from the US to Glasgow, and we'll need to have that signed. Now, that's the kind of practical example that is happening every day in Scotland, and I'm sure Stephen has had experience of similar conversations. I think this bill aims to address that in a positive way.
I just ask whether you've any comments on the previous evidence we'd heard about the choice of law having something to do with the nature of that law and the content of that law, or would you go with the previous comment that maybe people are just more familiar with English law, they know what it means, and you go with what you're used to?
I would say, primarily from my private practice experience, choice of law can be a very early consideration in terms of the document. We do look at choice of law as a positive way. There might be a number of things that affect that decision. Location of the counterparty or counterparties is an obvious one. To be perfectly honest, if they are English, or if you are talking about multiple counterparties, then yes, there is a draw towards English law as a common standard, so to speak. I think commercial practice can dictate that a number of types of contract are more prone to English law, whether or not it's international shipping contracts or those sorts of things tend to be governed by that, and that reflects the international standing of English law. I think there are other choices that are made where Scots law is the natural forum, and those are the situations where the convenience of execution actually does play a part in making a choice of law. And that could be something that you're determining at the outset, or it could be something that is a late call. I do think there are complications with making certainly a late switch from a Scots law document to an English law document, which, apart from the absurdity of having Scots parties in relation to Scots assets executing a document under English law so that they can not meet up, you introduce... I think Scottish lawyers are relatively adept at using English law, particularly company lawyers. I think that it was pointed out in earlier evidence that it is easier and more pragmatic for a Scots lawyer to draft up an English law document than it is to ask an English company to instruct Scots solicitors. But you do increase risks of error. Obviously, there are differences in terminology. Joint and several liability, or several liability, might be one of those. And sometimes we have oddities where you are changing the choice of law, but you are keeping the jurisdiction of the courts the same. So you have Scottish courts opining on English law. Messy in general.
Margaret, yeah.
Could I ask Catherine from Scottish Enterprise? Obviously, it's such a multinational company. I mean, it's a big company, Scottish Enterprise, and you do deal with organisations nationwide and also throughout the world. Is English law the first option for Scottish Enterprise to choose because of the ease of getting signatories on the final document?
Well, just to clarify a couple of things, Scottish Enterprise does enter into a lot of contracts, but doesn't transact in the same way as a commercial business would transact. So we're not trading as such. we would always use Scottish law because we are a non-departmental public body, and we have a great pride in the Scottish legal system, and therefore we would always look to promote the use of Scots law in the business that we would do. I think to sort of answer your question and also kind of touch on Mr. Don's question just around, you know, do people look at the substantive content of the law and does that dictate their decision, or is it just sort of habit? And I would say to an extent, from my experience, it's just habit and perception that English law is more universally recognised, it's a bit more practical, and it's kind of historic legacy that it's tended to become the law of commerce. I don't think that this change in this bill will necessarily make people who were not otherwise sort of connected to Scotland in some way suddenly flock to Scotland to use Scots law, but it will certainly make the messaging around Scots law and the utilisation of Scots law for commerce easier, I think, because at the moment we're in a situation where, for example, there's a work stream within Scottish Enterprise that's seeking to promote the Scots legal profession abroad, because one of our key strengths in the UK is professional services, and at UK level and at Scots government level, you know, there's an appetite to promote professional services and legal services. Now, in promotion of that, it's a good message to be able to say that it's practical, it's workable for business, and it makes Scotland a good jurisdiction to do business in. So,
thank you.
That brings us comfortably to where John Scott was going to go.
Well, yes, indeed, and at the risk of asking you to say the same thing twice, but I mean, opinions seem to vary as to what the benefits are going to be for Scottish legal practitioners. We heard from corporate lawyers last week who were saying this is great, bring it on. We also heard from others saying most recently today that it would not be transformative in terms of the business that this would bring to Scotland. What are your views on the likely economic benefits, shall we say, of this piece of legislation?
Difficult to crystal ball gaze in any, you know, with any certainty, but what I would say is that I think this will stop the drift of business in terms of contractual business from Scotland. I think that it's a fairly common event that parties, either at the outset of a transaction or at the 11th hour, will look to utilise the practicalities of English law around execution, and that's kind of what we're focusing on, I guess, at the moment, is looking at the purely the execution practicalities in terms of this bill, and I think that is a very real kind of occurrence, and therefore if we can stop that drift, that's going to have benefit for the profession in terms of the work that is done in Scotland, and in terms of Scots businesses having the ability to have a level playing field, if you like, with businesses from England and worldwide, and they can put a better message across to their customers that actually we can operate in a practical way, we can accommodate your needs. So I would hesitate to say it will suddenly bring a lot of business to Scotland, because I'm not sure that it actually will, but I think it will certainly stop the kind of movement of business from Scotland in terms of legal commercial contracts.
Thank you.
So,
in maybe dealing with that attraction of business and the economic benefit first, perhaps before maybe turning to some of the more generic benefits of the bill. I will echo, no, this is not going to make Scots law the choice for international parties to transact under. It clearly stops the exporting, which I think is a refrain that you've heard from many of your witnesses, and will allow the most appropriate forum to apply to contracts. There are, I guess, possibilities looking ahead as we start to look at more novel ways of entering into agreements or purchasing goods, as we move much more to internet-based transactions, and the conclusion of whether or not it's click-through agreements or giving consent through electronic media. I will be honest, I have not read and never tend to do those user agreements that you always have to agree to before you buy something online. But of course it would actually be quite interesting to see, or I would like to then hope that if Scots companies who are online and selling businesses online can use Scots law for their online transactions, because again, it would be a bit daft if we get all the way to the bottom of that online agreement and they say, and we're doing it under English law just because we're not sure. So bringing things home is fundamentally the question. For me, the benefit of the bill will be certainty, because I am going to tell you that people are doing this anyway. I think that people have been working ways of getting around the strict requirements of Scots law, and that we are currently undertaking transactions in Counterpart with electronic delivery, notwithstanding what the law currently says. And I think commercial practice is already there, and this is catching up.
Right, so you would say that this is actually just the law catching up with what's already happening. That's a very interesting observation. And you touched a moment ago on the suggestion that there might be opportunities for innovative use of this legislation. It was suggested last week that you know, beyond large commercial contracts, it would allow business to set up new ways of signing electronically, which possibly you're saying they're already doing. But
I am not necessarily advocating that it will allow Scots companies to become a world leader in a new way of transacting documents. It is just that whereas much of our content so far has been about moving from wet ink to a PDF copy of that wet ink document to electronic signatures, the more our agreements become done online, having a law that allows those contracts to be concluded online with certainty. So it's not necessarily technological innovation as such.
From Scottish Enterprise, do you see any opportunities for innovation with this piece of legislation?
I don't feel that I'm particularly qualified to comment on that. I think you inevitably businesses will, as something like this would bed in, businesses would work out, things would move on, things would evolve. I think we're seeing that in terms of the approach to, as Stephen referred to there, even signatures and the fact that you could have an entirely electronic document that is then signed electronically and actually exists in that virtual space. You know, these kind of innovations are happening all of the time, and I think that the businesses would develop innovative solutions, but I couldn't presume to predict those at this moment in time.
I think I may have already asked you this question, but you don't think that the bill is likely to attract business to Scotland which doesn't otherwise have a connection with it? You don't see that happening?
I mean,
this was a view put forward last week, and we would just really like to know if you actually think it would attract business to Scotland, because obviously we would be happier if it did, but if the real world is that it won't, we'd prefer to know.
As I said, I don't think it necessarily will attract businesses in Scotland that wouldn't otherwise have an interest in doing business in Scotland, wouldn't otherwise have a connection with Scotland in some way. I think it will stop the drift of business from Scotland. And it will certainly, I think, make parties who have that connection or desire to otherwise do business in Scotland already, I think it will make them feel more comfortable about the idea of Scots law, because certainly what I've come across in my former life as a private practice lawyer and also since moving in-house to Scottish Enterprise is that there's a general perception that there's something a bit different about Scots law, and it's a bit archaic and it's a bit kind of cumbersome and we don't really know the detail of it, but somehow it puts us off. And that kind of pervading attitude is certainly something that I've come across before. And I think being able to say, well, actually, you know, the Companies Act is UK-wide. In the commercial sphere, there's very little difference. And one of the more practical differences that exists in terms of lack of counterpart execution certainty has now been removed, or, you know, if this bill comes into effect, would be removed. I think that's a very positive message, making people feel more comfortable around Scots law, but I don't think it necessarily will suddenly make Scotland as a jurisdiction, you know, a key jurisdiction over any other place.
Thank you. Are you happy with that response? Thank you.
Margaret.
Yeah, just on that point, I'm just sort of sitting thinking, are you aware of any other countries that may use the current English law just now because of its ease of the signatories part of it?
For pure choice of counterpart execution, no. I think different jurisdictions will choose, or different parties in different jurisdictions will choose English law for a number of the reasons that we've already touched upon. Counterpart is not necessarily one of them. I think it is most acute between Scotland and England because the law which applies to the rest of the transaction is actually the same.
Thank you. Now just really for a point of clarification. After what I've heard, certainly from yourselves this morning, but also the previous panel, just it sounds to me as if there's a reputational issue that this bill is seeking to address. On the one hand, it will stop the drift of business using English law, but that then provides an opportunity further down the line to actually enhance and promote the Scots law for these types of transactions. And to me, it sounds as if there can be a positive outcome, maybe in about 5 years' time, 10 years' time, or whenever, to actually promote the use of Scots law and also the reputation of Scots law.
Certainly, I mean, we would argue at the moment that the reputation of Scots law is superb, and that we should be doing more to promote it as it exists at the moment, because it has many strengths, and indeed our lawyers have exposure to many areas and transactions where they develop expertise that expertise is exportable. For example, our oil and gas industry in Aberdeen, and the lawyers there are getting experiences that many lawyers across the world are not getting in terms of it being on their doorstep. The renewables projects that are springing up all over Scotland, again, that's giving rise to our lawyers sometimes being among the first to encounter certain issues with various projects and to overcome those. So those types of skills and experiences and knowledge already exist within the profession, and you know, we have to do more to enhance those. But certainly practical steps like this bill would see happen can only enhance that messaging and promotion.
If you forgive me, though, that it was yourself only a few moments ago that who used the word archaic in terms of Scots law.
Yes.
So that's why I was posing the questions regarding the reputation.
Absolutely, and I think that you know what I've just said there in that answer is about changing those perceptions, and I think that we should and can be changing those perceptions now. But I think if this sort of bill came in as well, then that would help in that process, because I think there is a misconceived idea that somehow Scots law is, you know, it's a separate system and people don't quite follow how, you know, if it's a separate system, is it really different? And then you have to explain, well, actually, in commercial terms, it's not actually that different across the UK. And, you know, that's the sort of dialogue that Scots lawyers are having probably, you know, every day at some point in Scotland with international clients. And I think steps such as this bill are sort of practical steps that can help in that discussion.
I think there are a variety of factors which contribute to the perception of a legal system as strong or positive or weak or archaic. The institutions that surround it, the effectiveness of the judges and the courts, the rule of law, all have great contributing factors to people relying upon Scots law, for example, as a forum in which they can get decisions that are not necessarily correct, but that the decision-making process is a solid foundation on which they can conduct their commercial activities. There are other things which contribute to a feeling that Scots law may be a bit behind the times. Execution and counterpart may be one small part of that. If we look at maybe the way that we plead our litigation hearings, use of Latin, the way that some of the property transactions have been done historically seem quite tethered to, I mean, it is not too long ago since property lawyers abandoned travelling drafts with coloured ink, and I'm sure you will probably still find those around in various places. So this is one small part of how you present your legal system.
Okay, I'm just wondering if we could move on to Margaret, please, on the issue of fraud and error.
Yeah, I mean, you've obviously, as you're saying previously, been using this system with other clients. How do they feel initially when you ask people to sign the signatory sheet and basically trust the lawyers to make sure that all the other pages, it could be like we've said 100, 150 pages, are all accurate and correct? How do, I know I've been asking about yourselves about the sort of the fraud aspect of it, but I'm sort of thinking, how do the business people actually feel about quite happily signing this sheet of paper and feeling confident that what they're actually signing is what they're actually going to get?
I would hope that on one level, you have a question about trust in lawyers and trust in your own lawyers.
Trusting that, you know, the paperwork is there. We're talking about maybe human error as well from the point of view.
Error and human error exist and will continue to exist. With a paper document, it is still possible and in fact still probable that you will find manuscript amendments throughout the document with little initials by them. So we are producing paper documents that have typographical errors or address changes already in them. I would like to think that employers should or should be able to take confidence in their own in-house counsel to put the bits of paper on the table that reflect that institution's will.
And what about sort of the fraud aspect of it? I mean, have you came across any examples of where this has actually happened, or have you heard of any examples of where it's happened?
I think that I would echo the evidence that's already been given to the committee that, you know, the potential for fraud and for error exists at the moment. I don't think this bill is going to eliminate that, or indeed open the door to a greater extent. you know, if people wish to be fraudulent, they will find ways to be fraudulent. I think, though, that the English system has operated on this basis for a number of years, and I'm not aware of any particular problems on that front. I think there is the issue of the trust between clients and lawyers, indeed regulated by a host of professional duties that a solicitor is subject to, and engagement letters, etc. And therefore, when a client would be asked to sign a signature page, they just think of the convenience of that, and they're usually quite happy with that because they trust that the proper document will be executed in that way.
And I mean, finally, I asked a question as well about risks possibly being reduced if the parties are required to deliver the entire document and counterpart, not just the signature page. What's your views on that from a sort of practical commercial point of view?
As Catherine said, there are a number of things which can mitigate risk. Your professional advisors, ethics codes, good practice, which the Law Society may promote, technology can all reduce fraud. In terms of the Faculty of Advocates' suggestion that principal copies of documents should be transmitted from or delivered from one party to the other, I think that it is no longer that common to find a bound engrossment in the same way that we did a number of years ago, because the first thing that you do is take off the binding and put it through the scanning machine. So documents are primarily circulated unbound in any event. As evidence earlier indicated, if we have dozens of parties to a transaction who are each sending 100-120 pages to each other, at which point the, in our bill's suggestion, the nominee can collate all the signature pages and put, you know, 99 pages back into the shredder, I would say that that seems a bit of an environmental waste and a practical inconvenience.
Yeah, that's fine. Thank you.
I would echo that. I think that if we are looking to enhance the practical application of the law in terms of the conclusion of contracts and the ease with which that's done, it would not make sense to then say, well, someone has to actually then send back an entire document. What I am aware of in England is that the Law Society, following the Mercury case, suggests that there is an option, and it's not obligatory, but there's an option where a solicitor could send a PDF of the final document along with a separate PDF attachment of a signature page to a recipient. The recipient would only have to print off the signature page, sign that, but when they return the signature page, they just essentially ping back by way of email that the PDF of the final document that was attached to the email that sent the signature page to them. And that's one of the options that the Law Society of England and Wales suggests following that Mercury case, as a way of matching up the signature page with the final document. But again, you know, I don't think that is particularly convenient for clients. And I think that perhaps strays away from what we're trying to do with this bill, which is to enhance the practical the speed with which and the ease with which contracts can be concluded.
I would say that actually I alluded earlier that parties were already using English law mechanisms to transact under Scots law, and the Mercury format of replying to the email, including the execution form of the document, here is the signature page to which here is my signature page and the document to which it relates, has become more commonplace.
Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret. Do you have anything to add?
No. That's excellent. Thank you.
Anything to add, Richard?
Yes, just on the issue of pre-signed signature pages, there's provision in the bill for those. So those seem not to be very widely used at all from what we can gather. I mean, do you have any views on their use and whether
the provision in the bill is therefore appropriate. Mr. Hart, I don't know if you've got particular, perhaps might be best directed to you.
I think what you have commonly heard, which is that it is best avoided, is, I think, probably the default scenario. I do not want to be obtaining pre-signed signature pages way in advance of a transaction. Having said that, commercial organisations can be affected by the availability of signatories or indeed the timing of the transaction. It may be that having negotiated and broadly agreed the terms of a document, that the engrossment version is not quite ready yet. We are still arguing about a point. We are waiting to hear back from a third party. Time is progressing. My board is unavailable or will shortly become unavailable. There is an implicit trust that the document that I approve for signature will be the document which we as an organisation may wish to enter into. There are times in which I may take the opportunity to benefit from that provision of the bill by obtaining a pre-signed signature page.
Pardon me, I think it's just worth making the point. I don't think the bill actually specifically allows of that, but nonetheless, it is effectively allowed in law if it becomes practice. So I think that's why we were discussing the issue. Does Catherine want to?
I would just say that I don't think that they are widely used, that practice is widely used in Scotland, and indeed I don't. It's certainly something I don't particularly feel comfortable with as a practice. I think that's probably prevalent across the profession, that it's just somewhere that we don't go, because of, you know, it's probably seen as one step too far in terms of flexibility. Yeah.
Okay, I think we've probably covered that. In which case, I think I'm on to Stuart McMillan. Please.
Thank you. What are your views on the likely benefits for business of the setting up of an electronic document repository maintained by the Registers of Scotland?
I think that I can see the attractiveness of that as a suggestion, because I think having a central repository for these documents would give a sense of security to the parties, where perhaps charging one solicitor or the other in a particular transaction to retain those documents might not give that same level of security to the other party. There's also the questions of practicalities for individual solicitors' firms in terms of size of storage required and length of time for which in terms of which those documents would have to be retained. So I think I can see the merit in the suggestion of a central repository. I think the sort of questions that would need to be answered would be around independence of that repository, funding of that repository, staffing, who would be responsible for it. I've seen suggestions in some of the commentary around the Registers of Scotland taking that on. I think that's something that could be explored. The Registers of Scotland are primarily a land register and primarily sort of linked to Scotland, and so I think that if we were utilising or looking to create a repository for sort of international contracts, for example, we would need to work out, I guess, how that fits with Registers of Scotland's role and remit as a Scottish registry for property transactions, and how that would then morph into something that was perhaps wider than that if they were to take responsibility for it. So these are the kind of questions that I think would need to be answered, but as a concept I can see the merit in it. Yeah.
I see a superficial attraction. I think that it is a potentially expensive technological solution to a problem that does not really exist.
Okay. In terms of the current practice, have there been any kind of major examples or any examples on a regular basis whereby a legal firm has maybe misused the legal documentation that they were actually saving and storing? So in order for maybe also this particular suggestion to have an independent organisation as a repository, I mean, you said it was a superficial attraction, but has there been any examples of kind of misappropriation or misuse under the current system?
Not of any, and I think that, again, I noticed in some of the evidence that's been given previously to the committee that the point was made that within the draft bill it refers to the parties instructing a nominated person to retain the relevant documentation. So I think that's a key point, that actually even if Party A instructed Party A's solicitor to destroy a document or to deface a document or to do something with that document, that solicitor could not do that because he's been charged by both parties to retain it for their benefit and on their behalf. So I think the bill anticipates that sort of and seeks to head it off, that sort of issue. But I think in reality, it's certainly something that I've never come across.
Mr. Hart?
No. No, I'm not aware of any situation.
Okay. Thank you.
Legal firm goes out of business. How do you access... Yeah, but these things happen. You know, what actually would happen then if that firm actually held all these documents electronically somewhere? What would happen? How could people then access those documents again at a later date? I mean, if you get hard copies in.
The answer is I don't know. I would have to defer to the Law Society of...
So do you think then maybe the idea of having this sort of central point where these electronic documents would be stored independently could be an option?
I can see the merit in it as a suggestion. I think there's quite a lot that would have to be worked through in terms of, you know, funding for that, staffing for that, responsibility for that body, updating of documents. You know, if you register a document in 2010 or whenever, well, I guess if we look forward in 2018, you know, and then the parties change that, how is that process managed whereby that copy would be updated? That's quite labour intensive, etc. So there would be all these questions to be worked through, but certainly I can see the merit for the reasons that you've touched on there.
Can I just thank Margaret for introducing that idea? I think we as a committee perhaps ought to take the advice of the Law Society as to how that particular situation is handled. Can I bring in Stuart Mitman?
It follows on from that as well. Just if there was a small firm that was tasked to actually maintain or to store these records, and not so much the business went into receivership, but the people decided to stop trading. They wanted to retire. What would actually happen with those documents? Because that's not...
I think I'm going to stop you there. I think we're going to take some specific advice on that.
Right, okay.
I don't think that's fair for this panel, to be honest, unless they have any particular comment, which I don't think they have. Right. I'm wondering, though, in the context, though, whether I could just pursue something about which I really have no idea. How long does the average commercial transaction really need to be held on to? And let me just put that in context. I mean, clearly, if somebody buys some land, they hold it forever until it changes. And one can see that as being open-ended. The average commercial contract, or even the long commercial contract, extends beyond 50 years, ever? 20? 25, perhaps, or
it depends.
Building under? I mean, so I'm just wondering whether there's a real need for something to be around for a very long time.
And yeah. I think Mr. Stevenson might want to...
Well, I'm asking the witnesses first.
Okay.
Sorry, I mean, you.
Clearly, it will depend on For example, a drug patent license will exist for the duration of the patent. An investment agreement, the principal terms of the investment will actually be concluded straight away. The nature in which the shareholders' arrangements are governed will continue until those shareholders change them.
So there are genuine contracts, which, other than the purchase of land, which really could be seen as going on for a very, very long time. Yes. And therefore holding on to the original document might actually be fair in some cases where you don't want to change it.
Correct. One of the issues that I don't know is whether or not your electronic repository and the digitization of that document allows for the destruction of the original, so that you, because otherwise you're doing two things. You're holding an original in a safe for 25 years and you have the electronic version. So
duplication. There is also a panel from Registers of Scotland to come, so some of this is to follow. Stuart, do you still want to come in on
that? I was just going to make the rather obvious one, because it's topical in light of what we'll be debating this afternoon, that if the documents related to the insurance of various properties in relation to claims that are now being made for mesothelioma were not available in perpetuity, there'd be a difficult position. Many commercial operations, in particular the railways, depend on legislation and contracts that are some, in the oldest cases, approaching 200 years old, etc. So I think it's beyond peradventure. You need to keep them forever.
Makes the point. We now perhaps get to electronic signatures. Stuart, is there anything you want to say on that in the context, please?
I'll just make the observation. I pay Mr. Google £1.68 a month for my 100 gigabytes of cloud, and all my documents live there, and the electronic keys are available to people after I'm dead. So it can be done for £1.68 a month. We'll see where we get to. But electronic signatures. I just wondered whether this bill that's before us and the form it's likely to have at the end of our deliberations helps or hinders the adoption of electronic signatures instead of paper and ink.
My view is that the initial impact of the bill will be reflective of current practice. The wet ink signature of a paper document, which is then scanned and used to conclude the nature of the transaction. Like Mr. Stevenson, I have experimented with digital certificates on PDFs. I would say that the greatest barrier currently is common adoption, or the fact that you can lead as much as you want, but if nobody else is using a key, then it becomes relatively pointless. And the other thing about maybe electronic signatures is whether or not we're talking about the conducting practitioner who is overseeing the transaction, or whether or not it is each individual signatory of a document. So in company law terms, whether or not each director, the company secretary, are all using their different keys, or
I would just push on this, since the whole business of key, of course, is a key payer, a public key which anyone can use to verify the signature, and the private key only available to the person who signed. And I just wondered in that context whether it would be useful if the public key, which is available to everyone to verify, were to be part of what's held in an electronic repository such as might be provided by the Registers of Scotland, so that at least while the ability to sign anew might be lost if the private key is mislaid, there's an enduring availability of the public key to verify the electronic signatures that's protected.
I
probably gone as far as we're going there, and I think we've probably got to Mike, please.
Thank you, convener. I just wondered if either of you have any other comments on the bill, or whether you feel there's been anything that's been missed out of the scope of the bill that could be usefully included.
I don't think so at this stage. I think that the aims of the bill are admirable in the sense that they're trying to address a specific problem and achieve a specific outcome, and to do that within a relatively short period of time, which I think is an admirable ambition. I think that there may be other areas in due course in terms of Scots law that might be looked at. I think some of that was referred to in earlier evidence given to the committee around perhaps electronic signatures, around delivery, around these sorts of concepts. But I don't think that there's nothing missing from this bill. I think this bill achieves or seeks to achieve a practical and very useful outcome. And you know, I think to bring in contemplation of anything else that would overcomplicate at this stage.
Thank you.
I think I have maybe 3 points to make in relation to the bill and possible absences. The bill allows for counterpart documents to be held undelivered until the parties agree that it is delivered. I think it would be helpful that traditional documents signed by all the parties could be held undelivered until it is agreed by the parties to deliver it. It would seem a little bit odd that if Catherine and I have signed counterparts of documents, that we can agree to postpone delivery, but if we sign the same document that it is deemed delivered at that time. My second point would be that while I applaud the use of the nominee structure, that the more implicit that is, the better. I think if parties adopt formal appointment of a nominee letters, then it is just another piece of paper that and another formality which is perhaps unwelcome. Now, whether or not law firms would introduce them into standard terms and conditions is a separate question, but when agreeing to that nominee, a relatively informal appointment should suffice, or indeed the fact that lawyers acting on behalf of parties might be deemed to be that nominee. And my third point would relate to what I would say a completed counterpart. Having executed a counterpart and exchanged them, and indeed the transaction having concluded, there is sometimes a natural abhorrence of empty spaces on the page. And under English law and practice, it might not be uncommon for the recipient to actually complete that counterpart. And they might do that for a couple of reasons. One would be so that they had one whole copy of the document. It might be so that if they needed to adduce it in evidence in court, they had at least a copy that signified that they were bound to the document. With the use of probative signatures, what we might have, a counterpart by definition in the bill is not executed by all the parties. So the process would presumably assume that the counterparties sign, and they may sign in a probative manner. I've signed this on the 7th of October. We intend it to be delivered on the 10th of October. We exchange. Catherine may arrange for SE to put their signature on things so that they have their own version, and that might be done on the 17th of October. The transaction date is actually already passed, but I suppose I would find it important to assume that the counterpart at the time that it was delivered was effective, and that putting a signature on it by the or the recipient putting a signature to it didn't somehow not make it a counterpart.
Yeah. Thank you for the detailed observations, which I'm sure others will address. Mike, do you?
Just one final question, convener. Do you agree that, I mean, the general approach of the bill is to be facilitative rather than prescriptive. Do you agree with that general approach?
I agree.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Right, we have had some interesting suggestions this morning, including some very detailed ones which we'll have to get other people to look at. I'm looking at my colleagues who seem to be finished, so can I thank you very much, both of you. John, sorry.
Further suggest, as I'm sure Nigel meant to, and not suggesting that you should have, but if you any observations you want to put in writing, or if you want to outline your proposals there, most recently expressed in writing, then that would be helpful, should you want to.
Yeah, okay. Can I thank you very much for your evidence to us, and we'll suspend briefly again just to let the witnesses change over. Thank you. convening. Thank you very much. It's now my pleasure to welcome Christopher Kerr, who's the head of legislation and legal policy, and Kenny Crawford, who's the commercial services director at the Registers of Scotland. Thank you very much for waiting, gentlemen, and thank you very much for the fact that you will have heard much of the previous evidence, which is probably going to help the process that follows. And I think our questions are started by Mike McKenzie.
And it's probably addressed to Mr. Crawford. I wonder if you could, just for the benefit of the committee, outline the how the books of counsel and session operate in practice and what benefit it offers to commercial parties and what type of documents are commonly registered in it.
Yes, I'm probably better handing initially straight over to Chris, who's our legal expert here. No problem.
The Books of Counsel and Session at the moment is a paper-based register. You can record in it all sorts of deeds, really, minutes of agreement, which most normally refer to family law matters, I would say. Leases quite often are recorded in there. Securities, standard securities, are often, as well as being recorded in the property registers, are recorded in the Books of Counsel and Session, and all manner of other deeds as well. The reasons are twofold, I think, for recording in the Books of Counsel and Session. The first is preservation of the deed, and that's simply a safe repository, and you can achieve from it an extract which has the evidential status of the original. And the second is execution, which where the deed includes some sort of obligation, typically a monetary obligation, an extract from the Books of Counsel and Session has the effect of a court decree, and it allows you to do summary diligence based on the deed without having to go to court.
Okay, thank you. And my next question then, following on from that, is that Section 1.3 of the Bill allows counterparts to be treated as a single document signed in probative form, and if necessary, that document can then be registered in the Books of Counsel and Session as a collated version of one counterpart, plus the various signature pages. Now, in our written evidence, the Keeper suggested that dealing with these new collated documents would only involve a minimal amount of retraining on the part of some staff. Could you confirm that would be the only requirement on ROS?
I think so, yes. Yes, I think that's right. The Books and Counsel and Session is a fairly straightforward register to run. It's not like the property register or the land register in particular, where the keeper has to take some sort of view on the effect of the documents. All that the keeper would typically check, or the keeper's staff on our behalf, would be that the document is executed in an appropriate manner. So there would be some retraining in order to ensure that staff understood the new rules of execution, or that this was a valid way of now executing a probative writ, and then they would record it in the usual manner.
Okay, thank you very much.
Stuart.
Thank you. Good morning, gentlemen. In the written submission from the Keeper, certainly in response to the call for evidence, the Keeper states that I understand that the Scottish Government intend to turn to this aspect of the Scottish Law Commission's report in due course, and I will be happy to come back to the committee with further detail on what the Register of Scotland may provide once we have looked at the detail of any system and sought further views from colleagues in the Scottish Government and our customers. This was regarding the electronic document repository. And so I'm keen to ask certainly whether that there actually has been any further detail on this comment, and whether it can be expanded in the current state of play as regards to the electronic document repository.
The focus has very much been on getting our systems ready for the implementation of the Land Registration Scotland Act, with designated date coming up on the 8th of December. So that's where we've spent most of our time in terms of IT development. The next phase of that, beyond that date, will be looking at our digital strategy, including replacing new systems and introducing new systems that will improve the conveyancing process. I think the intention there is that we, beyond designated, look at the systems we have and what we might introduce, and certainly this recommendation would be one of those systems that they may consider.
Mr. Kerr, do you have anything to add to that?
Not really, other than that we haven't had any more detailed discussions with colleagues in Scottish Government. As I think perhaps your last panel demonstrated, there isn't either, we think, a clear view amongst the profession about whether this would be useful, and if so, whether Registers of Scotland would be the appropriate body to run it. So at the moment, we've not really got any clarity on that.
Do you think that, that there are any benefits of the setting up of an electronic repository for legal documents, as opposed to the current paper-based system?
I think the only real evidence we have of that is obviously the system automated registration of title to land that we use currently, which is an electronic system that allows for simple transactions to be done online using a digital signature. And while the uptake of that hasn't been as we anticipated, it has dealt with over 90,000 transactions securely. So we can see evidence that there is a desire to move in that direction. There's also conversations going on with the Law Society in terms of what they do in the future and conveyancing with their smart cards. So yeah, you can see benefits of having a repository that people can use where if it's RAWS, then it's independent, it's held by the keeper, so it's trusted. There's obviously the resilience of ROS. We're not likely to go out of business. We've been doing this for almost 400 years, so we've got a track record.
Okay. Certainly, in terms of the some of the evidence that we've received up to now, that's been the issue of the scope of any type of repository, and also in the SLC report. Now that suggested that that a repository could be used for both negotiation and legal documents and the registration, either for the preservation or the preservation and execution. And it's also suggested that the system could potentially be used by non-Scottish parties, potentially globally. So do you have any thoughts on what the likely scope of a repository actually could be or should be?
I think for a repository to be used, or for an electronic repository to be used for execution as well as simply preservation, would require legislative amendment to the underpinning legislation for the Books of Counsel in Session. So I think what you'd be talking about there essentially would be creating an electronic aspect of the Books of Counsel in Session rather than a standalone electronic repository. Whereas if it was purely for preservation, then I think potentially you could have a repository without underpinning legislation. Whether it's only for Scottish parties or could be more international, I don't think we would really have a view on that, other than to say that, you know, we would happily hold it and register it if the market and if customers wanted it.
Mr. Crawford, do you have anything to add?
No.
Okay. Another area that's been considered has been the issue of the specifications of a repository, and we also heard something from the previous panels this morning regarding some of these issues, but also in the SLC report indicated that any repository must be completely confidential, secure, designed in such a way that all documents relating to the transaction are clearly linked and marked, and also durable for the long term, i.e. future-proofed, obviously software included in that, of course. Do you have any thoughts on any of these points, or would you like to comment on any of them?
It's not something we've explored yet. The registers, the 17 registers, obviously, that the keeper holds currently are open registers. So that would be a departure from where we are at the moment, and something that we would have to do a lot of research to understand what people were looking for and what's required to put that together. But as I say, it's not something we've investigated so far.
Certainly I'm not a technical boffin by any manner of means, but in terms of the issue that was raised earlier regarding software, but with the software that's already out there, I'm quite sure that that particular area could well be looked at and well be well be sorted out and future-proofed, so that any documents can be maybe looked at in 50 years' time, 60 years' time.
I mean, certainly we are aware that there are exchange repositories available at the moment which are confidential. So I agree with you. I think it is something that technology can can already provide.
I just wondered if Registers of Scotland were aware of and perhaps working with the National Library of Scotland, who are, by the sounds of it, a little bit ahead of you in terms of electronic storage and long-term preservation of documents, because it superficially would seem to me there might be overlap at technical and practical levels, albeit the job being done would be quite different. And I just wondered if that collaboration is there.
Not that I'm aware of. We do work with the National Records Office, and as I said earlier, we are exploring the digitisation of the conveyancing process, end-to-end conveyancing process. So that's something that, again, we would like to look at in the future.
Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, sorry.
So just one other point that has been raised, certainly in evidence, but also by the SLC, was an issue of a repository and a fees and charging structure. Certainly the SLC had indicated that any repository, if it were to be set up, would not be set up to make a profit, and that the charging structure should only cover the costs of the setting up and the running of the facility. They also suggest that the charges should be based on a fixed fee per document, and not, for example, on the value of the documents. So just wondering if you have any thoughts on what the SLC have suggested, and also on any of the evidence that you've heard and also read up to now.
As I said earlier, you know, we've not explored that, but ROS is a trading fund, so it's funded through the fees that we charge for the various services that we provide. So we would have to look at the various business models. We do provide statutory and semi-statutory products, which obviously recover the cost of what we do. So, you know, it's something that we'd look at to come up with our pricing model.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. I think that deals with that aspect relatively swiftly. But I'm grateful again for your attendance and for the evidence you have been able to provide to us. Clearly this is something in the future, and as we're all aware, not immediately in the bill, and I think that's fine. So may I thank you again, briefly again suspend the meeting just to allow our witnesses to leave in an orderly fashion, and then we'll deal with the rest of the agenda. Thank you. Thank you all. That brings us to agenda item 3, which is instruments subject to affirmative procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Road Traffic Act 1988 prescribed limit. Scotland Regulations 2014 draft. Is the committee content with this instrument, please? Thank you. Agenda item 4 is instruments subject to negative procedure. The South Arran Marine Conservation Order 2014, SSI 2014-260. There has been a failure to observe the requirements of Section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010. The instrument was commenced the day after it was laid, meaning the requirement to leave a minimum of 28 days between laying and coming into force has not been complied with. The committee may, however, wish to find the Scottish Government's explanation for this breach to be acceptable. Does the committee agree to draw this instrument to the Parliament's attention on reporting ground J, as there has been a failure to observe the requirements of Section 28(2) of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010? Does the committee agree, however, to report that it finds the Scottish Government's explanation for this breach to be acceptable? Thank you. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Town and Country Planning Control of Advertisements Scotland Amendment No. 2, Regulations 2014, SSI 2014-249, nor on the Legal Aid and Assistance by way of Representation, Fees for Time at Court and Travelling Scotland Regulations 2014, SSI 2014-257. Is the committee content with these instruments, please? Thank you. Agenda item 5 is instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014, Commencement No. 3, Order 2014, SSI 2014-251. Is the committee content with this instrument, please? Thank you. Agenda item 6, the Courts Reform Scotland Bill. This item of business is consideration of the delegated powers provisions in this bill after stage 2. Members will have noted that the Scottish Government has provided a supplementary delegated powers memorandum and will have seen the briefing paper. Stage 3 consideration of the bill is due to take place this afternoon. And the conclusion, the committee must therefore agree its conclusions today. Does the committee agree to report that it is content with the provisions in the bill, which have been amended at stage 2 to insert or substantially alter provisions conferring powers to make subordinate legislation or other delegated powers? Thank you. We are at completing agenda item 6. I now move the meeting into private. Thank you.